Hi everyone, I'm Mark, a GMAT instructor with Manhattan Prep, and I'm here with you today with a foundations level GMAT data sufficiency problem. Go ahead and pause the video, set a timer for 2 minutes, give this one your best shot. Okay, let's take a look. Even though we are working at the foundations level, it's important to recognize with this test that we have to have some key content pieces in place, and we have to have a really good process. So to start this off by giving you a couple quick mini lessons, one on data sufficiency process, and the other on least common multiples, which is the bit of content knowledge we need for this particular problem. Starting off with the process, if you're new to this question format, this is data sufficiency, what the cool kids call DS on the GMAT. This is gonna make up a little under half of the quantitative reasoning problems that you'll see. And it's likely new to you if you're just starting with the test. It's kind of a weird question format. So let's break this down into its component pieces and talk about how to approach this type of problem. Up top, we have what you might call the question stem. So I'm gonna call it that to distinguish it from the problem as a whole. So this is the question stem up here. Question stems always will have a question, of course. They often will come with given information as well. So here we've got this given right from the outset. We're told that X is a positive integer. So we know right away that X is something like 1, 2, 3, etc. So there's the given. And the question is asking us for the least common multiple. Now, questions in data sufficiency come in two flavors. Some questions are asking you for a yes or no response. Others, such as this one, are asking you for a specific value. If you knew the answer to this question, you would respond with a number. This number is the least common multiple. Now, down below, what we have are the statements. And there's always going to be two of these, statement one and a statement two. These are the givens. What you're ultimately trying to do here is not answer this literal question of what is the least common multiple. What you're trying to answer is essentially the meta question of whether this given information would actually be enough, would be sufficient to go answer the question. So that's what we're going after here. Finally, we have the answer choices, and these are consistent across all data sufficiency problems. It's exactly the same wording, exactly the same order of the answer choices. So ultimately, what you're trying to do is decide which of these is going to be correct. All right. Let's talk about the content side of things. So least common multiples. I'll take 12 and 15 as just a simple example. So if I take either of these and start looking at multiples, say 12 to start, I've got 12 times 1, 12 times 2, 12 times 3, etc. This goes on forever. I can also look at multiples of 15. 15, 30, 45, 60, you realize that we hit a point where we've got a multiple that is on both lists. So there's our first example of a common multiple. There are others, 120 would be on both lists as well, but this is our least common multiple because it's the first one that we see. So that's the definition. A slightly easier way to get at the least common multiple, or really any divisibility question, is to break your number down into its primes. The primes are the divisibility DNA of the number. They encode all of the divisibility information you would want to need to know. So 12 breaks down into 3 and 4. 4, I can go further into 2 and 2. So I see here 2 squared times 3 is the prime factorization of 12. 15, a little more direct, I just get a 3 and a 5, and there I have it. So I could also get to this least common multiple being 60 by just thinking about what primes I would need to cover both of these. So since the 12 has 2 copies of 2, I need 2 copies of 2 in the least common multiple. I've got a 3 in the 12 and a 3 in the 15, but I actually only need a single 3 in the least common multiple because I just see a single 3 in each of these two numbers. So as long as I throw in that 1 3, 12 is going to be covered, 15 is going to be covered. The one final piece I need to fully cover 15 is a 5 as well. And you can check that this also works out to 60. So. We've got the process for this question format, we've got the content. Let's head back to that particular problem and see if it feels a little bit easier, a little more approachable now. So I'm gonna rephrase this question. What do I really need to know if I'm looking for the least common multiple of 12, 15, and X? Well, I already know what it takes to cover the 12 and the 15. The real question is just what else is needed to cover the X? So what other primes, and by other primes, I mean other than 2, 2, 3, and 5, are needed to cover that x? That's the real question. If I can answer that, then I can go figure out what the least common multiple is. Let's dive into the statements. We need to tackle these one at a time here. So for statement one, x is a prime number. I'm already pretty suspicious of this. I don't feel like this is going to be sufficient because there are infinitely many primes, but let's confirm it. I'm going to test cases to just demonstrate that I can get different answers here. So on the one hand, x could just be 2, and then that doesn't do anything to the LCM because 2 is already covered, so it's still 60. On the other hand, x could be something like 7. And then I would need to toss a 7 into the LCM calculation, so that would provide a different value there. This is not sufficient to answer the question. Pause the video for a sec. If you're new to data sufficiency, ask yourself which choices are now eliminated. Did you get A, that's eliminated, and D is also eliminated? We know that it's not the case that both statements are sufficient on their own, since one is already not sufficient on its own. So A and D can both go. This handy little trick for writing the answer choices we call the data sufficiency elimination grid. It's a nice way to keep track of things. Now, I'm gonna go to 2 and evaluate this on its own terms. X is less than 7. Well, now that's not gonna provide too many possibilities. Let's just lay them out here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6. Are any of these gonna provide something new that I don't already have on the list? 2, I got that covered. 3, I got that covered. 5, I got that covered. 4 is 2 twos, I got that covered. 6 is a 2 and a 3, I've got that covered. So no, the LCM here is going to be 60. And what really matters is that this data was sufficient to answer the question. So final answer here is B. Make a plan to come back to this in a few days. Get a little bit of what learning scientists call spaced repetition. It's a great way to get some of these takeaways to stick with you long-term and also to test yourself to make sure you really understand it. Sometimes we can get this false sense of mastery when we're walking through something with an expert. You want to make sure that this is something you could replicate on your own on test day. Subscribe for more GMAT Math Spotlight videos from Manhattan Prep and leave us a comment telling us how you solved this problem. Happy studying!